speaker is Dr. Rachel Adam from Hebrew U. And Rachel Adam has worked for Israel's Environment Ministry for close to 16 years, during which she worked extensively on multilateral environmental agreements. She then became an advocacy lawyer and was co-founder of a leading community-based environmental organization, Ramot, for the environment in Jerusalem. She received her doctorate in international biodiversity law from Hebrew University Faculty of Law, where she's now teaching environmental law. Her doctorate was published in 2014 by UPNE Press, entitled Elephant Treaties, the Colonial Legacy of the Biodiversity Crisis. Right.
As I saw your book.
Lucky you.
At his office.
So, Rachel, so if everything is set, so 20 minutes.
Just remind me.
I will.
10 minutes, okay. So, can everybody hear me?
Yeah.
Okay, so I'll just say up front that I'm an environmental activist, and I know less about human rights. But what I've come to learn over the last few years is that the link between human rights and rights of the environment is so tight that you just can't discuss one without the other. And I really hope to persuade you today how important it is to recognize rights for nature in order to protect human rights as well. And this photo is an image of really of a river in grief because all the garbage that's been thrown into it. And of a little boy in grief. Look at him holding his head. So nature's in grief. Humans are in grief at what we are doing to the planet. So I sit on the board of an organization called Earth Law Center, and they try to promote laws for Earth, for nature. And their main thesis is that today environmental laws aren't working because they're really products of capitalistic system, economic system, which is to feed off the earth to create more and more products or make other people rich. And we have to really need new laws for this. So they had these two really very thorough documents in 2015 and 2016 where they showed how human rights are linked to environmental rights and the opposite. So I also sent these. I mean, these are available on the website, whoever wants to read more. And my presentation will be based on it. Okay, so to protect human rights, we must recognize nature's rights, just as we have rights to social nature. And this is really based on Christopher Stone's Should Trees Have Standing? Has anybody read it here? Well, his whole idea was that once women didn't have rights, the disabled didn't have rights, children didn't have rights, but as society evolves, they recognize that not just white men have rights, but other people too. And so does his nature. We should recognize that trees have rights, mountains have rights, other species have rights. It's an evolving approach to rights. Okay, and a really interesting example is in the States, Pennsylvania, where Ecosystem was a party in a claim against a company that was dealing with fracking. Do you know what fracking is?
Mm-hmm.
Fracking is when, because they can't reach oil wells, they don't have oil wells left really. I mean, they're all like been drained already, so they go next to like what's further down in the earth. I mean, really like draining the earth of the last few drops of fossil fuel. And it's a terribly, terribly polluting system, fracking. So this community, they had a bylaw that gave rights to ecosystems. And the oil company sued the community for saying, that's ridiculous, you can't have rights for ecosystems, and you're really infringing on my right, the company's right, to come and frack. So the ecosystem filed, joined the lawsuit to say, yes, I do have a right to exist and to flourish. So it worked for a while, but in the end, the courts in the United States, especially today under Trump, threw the ecosystem out and said ecosystems don't have rights. But it was a nice try, and this is what this organization, the Earth Law Center, is trying to do. Now, a case that, just 1 minute on this, a similar case that I worked on was in 2005. Have you heard about filed a petition for the Gazelle petitioner in its Ben Akdal in Jerusalem. So the government wants to build, still wants to build, on the Gazelle's habitat in Jerusalem. And we, that's how we have an organization about the environment. We've just been fighting it for years. And at one stage, we went to court, but we took the Gazelle with us. Now, Dorit Beamish was the Supreme Court Justice at the time, and she did not mention the Gazelle at all, but we won the case. And the Gazelle still has its habitat in Jerusalem. And they still want to build there, but we're doing okay. We're succeeding. And that really is an example of rights for nature. The Gazelle has rights even to be a petitioner in court, and whoever wants to look this up on the Supreme Court website, go into this, into our case, and you will see that we had Tzvi Yisraeli, he's petitioner number 6. Okay, so what is the source of all these, of what we call co-violations? Co-violations, meaning violations of human law and violations of nature's law, nature's rights. So it's a global economic model that's based on unlimited growth. Governments today, corporations, do not believe there's any limit to growth. The earth is unlimited and we can grow and grow and grow, absolutely no consequences. But of course that's ridiculous because we are a very limited planet and we live within planetary boundaries. If something's not clear, don't, and I don't mind taking questions in the middle. And we're really coming across up across those boundaries, like climate change. I mean, climate change, where we've been reading the reports recently, is totally catastrophic. I don't even know if we have 50 years. I don't even know if we have 10 years. You reach a tipping point, you don't know what could happen. And this is all because of the global economic model. Again, unlimited economic growth on a limited planet that eats up nature, natural. I don't like to call them resources. There are no such thing as natural resources. There's nature, and it returns it as garbage. Okay, so the main points that I want to bring across is rights of nature is a concept that evolved really to stop human exploitation of nature. We're saying if we want to, we have to like level the playing field, just like corporations have rights, which is totally ridiculous. Because what are corporations? They're not human. I mean, they're nothing. But if you can give corporation rights, you can surely give a gazelle rights. I mean, gazelles are much more closer to us than corporations. And co-violations are the entwinement of violations of human rights and rights of nature. Now the most important thing is indigenous. Indigenous are the ones who are most hurt by violations of nature's law. They are right out there living with nature. And they're the ones who get hurt directly from destruction of nature. And again, the root cause is the global, current global economic model based on unlimited growth, which feeds on exploiting nature. And who's responsible? The baddies in all the story? It's clear, it's the government and corporations.
Can I ask one question? Why do you and your group think that it's so important that a gazelle is a petitioner or the ecosystem is a petitioner, as opposed to we are representing?
Because it didn't work.
Are representing this community which is being destroyed.
Why? Because we had appeared before planning committees and we explained how the gazelle can go extinct all over the building. And they just totally ignored our arguments. There was absolutely no addressing the situation of the gazelle following the building, following the development. So we were like fed up. It was like totally ignoring another species. So I have to say, I admit it was kind of like a gimmick.
Yes, it sounds gimmicky.
It's gimmicky, but you need gimmicks sometimes. It's not
wait,
you have to capture the human.
I think...
I want a contribution for later within the...
Okay, so let's try to keep the structure, because
okay,
so, you have only 20 minutes.
Okay, you have to capture the public imagination in order to get them on board. And once we did that, we got them on board. We said, what? It was really good experience. And it was also my lifelong goal after reading Christopher Stone's book in law school. I always wanted to do it. Okay, so these are primary sources of co-violations, which are fossil fuels and mining, which are the major industries that are leading to co-violations, and agriculture. As we'll see, it's palm oil. Do you all know what palm oil is?
Mm-hmm.
So that's a huge problem, too. and nature's rights violations are mostly biodiversity loss, which is, biodiversity loss is when you take any natural area, peel off the green cover, trees, shrubs, animals, and leave it just barren. That's biodiversity loss. And of course, species endangerment, what happened with our gazelle, climate change, pollution, deforestation, and other habitat destruction. And these really, like, they go together, like pollution, deforestation, is also palm oil and mining and oil. Okay, and the first case I want to bring up is North Dakota. I'm sure you all followed it, Sandy Rock, which really captured the public imagination for about a year. Everybody, I mean, thousands of people came to protest the Dakota Access Pipeline route, which is a bad thing. Because, first of all, oil is a bad thing because it's gotten us in trouble that we are now and that we're really on the fringes of the unknown because emissions of greenhouse gases, and you don't want to encourage production of oil, you want to encourage alternative energy. And oil also pollutes the ground, the water, and it hurts people. You see here the Standing Rock Sioux Tribe, who were not consulted at all about putting down this pipeline. Just one day they show up and start building it. And they were met with a brutal force by police, not only by police, by private security forces. The company building the pipe was terrified, and they brought in private security forces to fight them. Okay, and the human right concerns, like I said, first of all, it's public health, water pollution, it's their water supplies, and it's also cultural. These are their sacred tribal areas. Okay, so Everett doesn't know, just this pipe carries oil, 500,000 gallons of crude oil per day from North Dakota to Illinois, and the use of the oil produces carbon emissions, and leaks from the pipeline threaten water and wildlife. And just so you know what the major problem is, here's a photograph of putting in these pipelines. Now, once the pipeline is in and it's covered, you really don't know what's going on underground. I mean, above ground, even though they're more dangerous because they can get hit by missiles or whatever. Once it's underground, you have to really monitor it to know what's going on. Leaks. And it could leak for years and no one will even know. And we've had that problem in Israel. And does anybody remember the Abrona oil spill in 2014, 4 years ago? Exactly 4 years ago. So, I mean, if you talk about oil spill, this was an oil spill. There was a pipeline from Israel-Iraq line that goes from Eilat to Ashkelon, and they were fixing it, or they wanted to move it because they're building a new airport, and it just broke apart. And you had such a terrible tragedy. First of all, people got sick. People from the neighboring town had to be evacuated from their homes. And it took years to rehabilitate the nature reserve there. I mean, it killed animals, the ground, and the water. So oil spills are a serious thing. Okay, now what the energy company did, so they got so angry, they got lawmakers to start really making laws harsher. So they're criminalizing laws that would even to stand in an area where there is a pipe underneath, we make it criminal. And this, of course, is to, and since Standing Rock, 56 bills have been introduced in 30 states to restrict protests. And remember, you have the XL pipeline, which is going into operation in February 2019, and there's been much less demonstration and protest because people are terrified. These are federal laws, and there's felonies too. People who go to jail, and the fines are huge. So that's how the energy companies, the corporations, are trying to keep the protests down. And unfortunately, they're succeeding. Okay, and this is just a photo that I just wanted to show to you of a law enforcement officers point their weapon at two water protesters. This is at Dakota, at the Dakota Access Pipeline. Both were arrested together with the town. Okay, and again, well, on the one hand, the Dakota Access Pipeline really managed to create a global interest, wide interest in what was going on. Hundreds of people were arrested. Most of them, the cases were thrown out because of lack of evidence, but it was terrifying for people to have to, you know, have the fear for months and months and months over what's going to be. And they call them eco-terrorists. And this quote is by the head of GAIN, which is Rail America's Infrastructure Now group that says we need more and more infrastructure. And they call them eco-terrorists. And they say we have to get super tough with them in order to protect the infrastructure. Okay, and then the Energy Transfer Partners, one more thing it did was it's suing all the environmental groups, Earth Justice, against Rainforest Action, which is of course a slap suit. A slap suit is a lawsuit that a corporation files against protesters in order to scare them off. It's probably from multi-million dollar claim. So this is how they're getting back the protesters. And Greenpeace, in response, has put together a document, Too Far Too Often, which details the unethical tactics employed by the energy companies against the Apple, which is the Dakota Access Pipeline, and treating protest as terrorism. So U.S. plans crackdown on Keystone activists. And we're talking about co-violations of nature and of human rights. And I want the U.S., unlike countries that we'll see soon in South America, is not going out murdering the protesters, but they're doing everything to shut them up. Okay, now what I want to point out, it's not just southern countries which have these problems. It's the U.S., it's Canada, it's Northern Europe too, which is the Sapmi, which is Lapland, and the Sami indigenous. Northern European countries want to mine the Arctic Circle, and this is definitely in violation of the indigenous Sami's rights to keep their cultural way of life. They herd reindeer, and they're just coming in and tearing up their land. But it's Europe's last wilderness. I don't have much time for this, so I'm going to go fast. So there are both human rights concerns, and there are also environmental rights concerns. In Germany, I mean, we all think of Germany as very green, but Germany mines the most polluting coal there is, which is called lignite. So despite all what they say about going green, they are still very highly polluting regarding their coal, their power plants. And to get to this lignite, they had to dig up this, one of the last remaining natural forests in Germany. And you had protesters building houses in the trees to protect the trees, but it doesn't seem to help. It's very, very hard to find governments and corporations. And we all know that with the environment too, when their goal is money and to create more products, to get more oil out of the ground and more minerals and gold and ore, iron ore, it doesn't work. It's still very, very hard. Okay, and the same thing in Sarnia, Ontario, which is Canada's Chemical Valley. The members of the local tribe there, who live in the shadow of this huge petrochemical industry, and they're very sick. They have high cases of cancer. They have like weird statistics, like 2/3 of their children are girls, only 1/3 are boys. It's really messing up the whole biological system. And that's humans. And of course, there's nature as well. And the same story with tar sands. Has anybody heard about Canada's tar sands? It's labeled the most polluting project on Earth. You can see it from planes. And what they do is, it's to get bitumen, which is another kind of oil. But to get to it, you have to peel off the top of the Earth. Huge mines and the leachings of which go into water. it stretches out for 50,000 square miles of forest land. I mean, that's a country. And all you see is these terribly barren areas of dirt and water and oil. I mean, all the beautiful forests have been, like, totally cut down. The caribou, the moose are all in danger because of what they're doing. And all the toxics from the mining go into water. And again, there are humans there. Okay, so can I have another 2 minutes just to do it fast? 1 minute, okay. And then of course there's Indonesia, Malaysia with the palm oil, which is ubiquitous. It's in almost all products. I really do read ingredients and I do try to buy, I won't buy anything that says palm oil on it. But I don't know about soap, I don't read that, I have to start doing that as well. But it's supposed to be a good thing, but it's cheering up the country. What it looks like after they fire, after they burn their forest to make way for the palm oil plantations. Destroyed forests. This is what it looks like, the palm oil. And of course, there are the indigenous there. And they're just cutting down their homes. I mean, they're throwing them out. And they're forcing them to work for the palm oil industry. And they're forcing them to go to the cities and become part of the city, poor in the city, instead of leaving them in their homes and letting them, and of course the saddest is what's going on with the orangutans. I mean, orangutans inhabit these forests. I think there are only like 50,000 left in all the world in the wild, and they're totally destroyed their habitat too. So, and they kill them. They kill them because they don't want any problems. Okay, Papua New Guinea. So, we'll have to wrap up. Okay, Ecuador, which also monkey violations. Chinese are coming in. And which is very strange about Ecuador. Ecuador has an amazing constitution from about 10 years ago, and they have a whole chapter on the rights of nature. But it doesn't help at all. Doesn't help at all. The government so easily ignores it when it comes to money, bringing in the corporations. And I'm just going to, and of course we have the murder of the 2015 Golden Environmental Prize winner, who was murdered in Honduras for her protest. Okay, so.
Yeah, you want to just wrap one sentence. Okay.
So what I want to say is they're trying. We're really trying. 2017 was the deadliest year. What my group is trying to do is to promote the Universal Declaration of the Rights of Mother Earth. We're trying to get it into the UN General Assembly and have it passed as law, which would be a great thing, but I suppose even when it becomes international law, it will be like other international laws, and it really won't help much. But it doesn't matter, you still have to get through with it. And the next thing we're doing is international rights of nature tribunals, even though of course they don't have any actual authority or force. It's really to get the other side to come and show.
Okay, thanks.